It really is.
I'm all right with it.
So yeah, I must do this. All
right, we have to smile.
Can we just like start when you guys walk in?
Sophomore in the old high school, which no longer exists. It was across from the park. Remember we talked about that with local history. I remember walking up the steps in the old high school. There were maybe four or five wooden steps. And the trophy that's now down by the calf was to the right in a small trophy case. And then eventually when this school was built, it gravitated with all the other trophies. So I wanted it in a place of honor. You can tell them whatever you'd like, talk about the old days, where you've been, what you've been doing, and ask any questions you want. When's lunch? About 20 till?
I don't know. We're supposed to be on an alternate schedule, but the bell didn't ring last time.
I think the alternate schedule is just you're going to miss like 10 minutes of fourth block.
I think so.
So no. I think it's, is that right?
I don't know.
I think
lunches would be normally.
I'm just here for
what's that?
Lunches should be normal.
Normally. So if you want to sit, or you want to sit, or you want to.
A little bit of everything.
A little bit of everything. And Amy, you can come on in.
Okay.
How about Kiefer, you want to move over and see your two? Or can then you can just take a chair. And
Mr. Sirianni, take attendance.
I took attendance.
Is that take attendance?
Yeah.
Well, that's probably why you're here then.
I've got
a problem. When I was your age, and if teacher were gonna tell me that somebody's coming in to talk about something that happened 66 years ago, I'd find some way to skip out. I don't know if everybody heard my name. I put it up here because being in high school, does that remind you of anything or ring any bells? Is there anything familiar about it? Anybody see anything that, oh yeah, I know that. Nobody. I'm kind of disappointed. I'm going to talk today until Mr. Sirianni tells me to stop or I run out of material before the class ends, whichever comes first. And if anybody, try not to fall asleep. I still have this problem, this time differential. Anybody here live in East Kane?
No East Caners?
Nobody. You know where Spring Street is?
Yeah, that's the first left, by the church, by the...
It'd be the, towards East Kane, it's the second street off to the right.
The right there.
There's a yellow house right by the railroad tracks. That's where I grew up. And it wasn't living on the wrong side of the tracks, it was living on the tracks. I think the house is about this far from the tracks, and at that time, before the interstate highway, there was an awful lot of train use, and there were two tracks, trains going by all the time, and whoever lives there now doesn't have to...
Now, did you walk to high school then?
Pardon?
Did you walk to high school every day?
No, that's another point. In the caste system that existed then, the people who lived in town were kind of here. People who rode the bus, of which I was one, were kind of here. Well, with the school moving here, the critical mass of the Kane metro area has shifted toward East Kane. And I'm sure if I were here, I'd be ranked much higher than I was on Chestnut Street.
You'd be the upper crust.
Yeah, that's right. Even living by the tracks. Anyway, I've got some things to talk about. A little bit about the game 66 years ago. Some stuff about personal conduct, some ways to perform, and maybe some work experience and some future stuff. When talking about the game, I'm not going to try to drag you through the minutiae of what happened at that game. But I would like to explain a little bit how, not in retrospect, how the trophy became so important and why it was such a big deal at the time. And here's kind of a way to think about it. Here's Pennsylvania. And about right here is Kane. And here is Scranton and Wilkes-Barre, and here's Philadelphia, and here's Pittsburgh. Here's Erie, but that was kind of by accident. It could be part of New York or Ohio, one of the two. You could, even today, you can go to these other parts of Pennsylvania and tell them you're from Kane, and they'll say, where's Kane? Now, living in Kane may give you a different perspective, but to the Pennsylvania world, we're out in the boonies here. There's nothing big around. These other sections are much more densely populated and probably not as nice a place to live as Kane. But the way things worked, and you'd have to remember that without television and with very little radio, people knew less about Kane from here then than they do now. So, in 1944, I guess, a guy named Stuart Edwards came to Kane to be a teacher at the high school. I did a little bit of research on him, and he graduated from Bloomsburg in 1940 or 1941. He came to Kane around 1945. The background says that he left Kane in 52. He was back at Bloomsburg in 58. So between 52 and 58 and 41 and 45, he taught at about five different schools in four different states. I don't know if he ever coached basketball before he came to Kane or not. I didn't see any indication of it. Of course, at the time, I didn't think about it. So I don't know if he ever coached basketball before. He taught math in high school. Didn't act physically when we were practicing. He didn't act like he was a particularly good basketball player. He wasn't very fast, and he wasn't very agile, and he, pardon me ladies, shot like a girl, almost. But he was a heck of a basketball coach. So that was kind of one part of it.
What made him a good coach?
Pardon?
What made him a good coach? I mean, what about him is good?
What made him a good coach? Two things I would say. That's a good question. One of them is that he really was a people person. He looked at everybody kind of individually, and he looked at the whole thing holistically, and how does it fit into a bigger picture? Just to give you an example, I'm sure there were more, but I can think of six people that he got to go to Bloomsburg to go to college just while I was there. He was that kind of a draw, and it wasn't because of basketball necessarily that he was sent there. The other thing was, as far as basketball is concerned, he was very much a fundamentalist. We really practiced. We did a lot of laps around the gym every day. We had a lot of medicine ball exercise every day. We had scrimmages every day. And as the team matured, the second team was very good. The second team probably could have won the Allegheny Mountain League by themselves. But what I was, so I hope that answers your question. What the second thing was, in addition to having a super coach, suddenly appeared some really good athletes. In 1946, I guess it was, there was a guy named Buck Byam, who you may have heard of. He lives in Williamsport now, and he's very closely associated with the Little League World Series. I think the broadcast booth is named Bill Byam or something like that. He's been very involved. He came along, and then a second guy came along the next year, and then the year after that, I'll mention his name, Norm Thompson, because I think he still lives in Kane. And he is the older brother of a guy who helped make Don Frase be here today when he was on the team and missed a foul shot. So the team got better. I guess he won the Mountain League the first year. The second year, he might have won District 9. The third year, he won District 9. And then the fourth year, he won, I think there are 12 districts in the state, something like that. Here's District 9 up here. Well, in 1948, the team won essentially Northwestern Pennsylvania, and they played the winner of Southwestern Pennsylvania and lost.
So the Western Finals, basically.
Yeah. So, that's right. So, here's Kane still. Recall what I said at the beginning. Nobody knows where Kane is. Well, they didn't do anything to blast their way out of the northwest part of the state in 48 either. And then I wanted to say, when I was about in sixth grade is when what I'm telling you started. And these people I referred to were my heroes. That's how I wanted to be. I wanted to play basketball. I wanted to be like these guys that I used to, living in East Kane, I used to walk to the games, and we didn't have a car. And it was pretty, I recall a lot of long winter nights in January and February walking past where the school is now to get home. It was worth it to me because there was nothing for me like these games.
How was the crowd? Big crowd?
Crowd? I don't know how it started out, but in 48 and 49, if you can picture where the old high school was on Chestnut Street, there was a sidewalk that went into the gym from Chestnut Street, and it was a long sidewalk.
That's still there. That's still there.
On game nights, every single night, the line was from the door into the gym, out to Chestnut Street, and up Chestnut Street through the next building. There was a vacant lot there, and I remember the line used to be up there. The gym, to me, was a very nice gym, and I don't know how many people it held, but the game baskets, there were courts that went crossways too, but the game baskets were fairly near the end walls, and I can remember the walls standing. I don't think there was, in those 2 years, and maybe in the subsequent 2 years, I should know those too, I don't think there was an empty seat or an empty place to stand, for that matter. Something to keep in mind, and to put the whole thing in perspective, was I have it in my notes, I think. Somewhere I have the number of teams, oh, here we go. You haven't missed a thing. Just to give you a sense of what the sports world was like, at that time, the NFL had 12 teams. Now they have 32 teams. The Major League Baseball had 16 teams. They got 30 teams. The NBA had 11 teams, and now they have 30 teams. And the NHL had 6 teams, and now they have 30 teams. So there wasn't, and in addition to not that much other sports, there were only three sports in Kane, basketball, track, and football, no other men's sports, and there were no women varsity sports at all. So basketball kind of filled a spot for people around Kane. And there wasn't any television, there wasn't any iPhone, there wasn't all the other stuff you people have access to, but where the drive-in in is used to be an airport. And so Kane was a perfect place to have a good basketball team. And coincidentally, we did. And I mentioned how these guys were my heroes. I suspect other people of my contemporaries felt the same way. That was the second thing. There was the coach, there were these good players to start out, and the third was the YMCA. There was a pretty good basketball court at the YMCA, and we played basketball 12 months a year. We played as a team for 12 months a year.
You don't know where the Y used to be? You know where the Black Cherry Cafe was? Right next to that building.
What is that now?
It's hotel, or it's not hotel. Sweet. My friend's dad owns the building, and in the basement, it still has some of the basketball floor.
Oh, really?
Some of the court floor. So.
It was kind of like a pecking order. When I first went there, which was probably in sixth or seventh grade, I'd have to wait to get into play with the players, and the older I got, the less time I had to wait. But it was always, as I recall, it was always filled with basketball. So we were into basketball, and here was this stuff was spinning around up here, and nobody knew about it. When in 49, we didn't lose a game in the Mountain League. Our record was 17-3. We lost two games to Warren and one game to Bradford. take the two games, if you add the points together for the four games, which I did last week, yeah, thanks to you people, I've done a lot of reviewing of my boyhood. We our aggregate score for those four games was greater than Warren and Bradford. And then I looked in 5 years, my wife graduated in 52, a year after I did, so we have 5 yearbooks, and we outscored Bradford and Warren by 8 points or something during those 5 years. So we were a pretty good team, and we were maybe the world's best kept secret. So in 49, when we won 17 and won 17 last three, and I just described those 3 points to you, here was a team over here that went 28-0. One of the victories they had was they beat the 48 state champions. So it was like some people have said it's greater than the story about the Hoosiers. We were really underdogs. And I have some... Suriani showed me a lot of stuff you have put together. You probably have more than I do on it. But I found it, just a few snippets from paper articles. Here's one about Ashley. Winner over powerful Plymouth, that was the prior year's champion. The Ashley team was one of the top favorites in the state. Plymouth was District 2 champion 2 years in a row and had a 6'9 center. Ashley, in the strength of his 20-game string of victories in an undefeated 48-49 campaign, is ruled a favorite. Here's one from United Press International. This gives you an idea of the publicity that the sport was given. Talking about Ashley will win. They have rangy basketball players gifted with precision shooting, fast breaking, ball handling, and cage setting, which has produced 28 victories for a perfect season. So we really were underdogs, and we didn't know it. In fact, when I think back about it, at the time, it was another game. We earned our way to won this thing, and this, so now we're going to play over in this part, and they switched state sides each year for the championship, and it was our turn, and right over in here is a town called Farrell, and they picked Farrell to play the game because Farrell had a 3,500 seat capacity. I don't know what Kane had, but 3,500 is a lot of people for a high school anyway. Ashley had a 75-member traveling marching band. I looked in our yearbook and we had, I have to be in the band. We had 30 people in the band, and we didn't even have any uniforms. And we didn't go to any games as a band either. So there we were, and I guess the way the tickets worked out, I assume Ashley got half the tickets, and Kane got half the tickets. So there were about 1,700 or 1,800 fans from each town at the game. And so it was a huge crowd for us. I don't know how it was for Ashley. But try to put yourself in, not so much in the place of Kane. Kane, but in the place of Ashley. They knew they were the heavy favorites. At halftime, they were ahead by 1 point. And with this much time left on the clock at the end of the game, they were ahead by 1 point. And they had the ball in their end of the court. What possibly could happen? Fellow that I referenced, Jim Thompson, stole the ball. And you know, this is snatching defeat from the jaws of victory when you think about it, because they have the ball in their end of the court, and everybody knew how much time was left. Why not just hold it or call timeout or do anything? You almost had to work at it to give up the ball, but here was Jim Thompson, who, which is another lesson to be learned, never quit. He intercepted the ball. If they wouldn't have touched him, he couldn't have gone down. He had to go the whole length of the court. He wouldn't have made it. But they fouled him. I was the tallest guy left on our team at that point. So I was nearest the basket when Thompson shot the foul. If you were going to have a technical foul to be shot on that team, Thompson is probably the guy that would have shot. He was probably the best shot on the team. And he missed the foul shot. And there I was, and I tipped it in. So to go from their ball at their end of the court with this much time, and they're ahead by 1 point, they went from that and that much time, and they lost the game.
Watch. All right. Okay, we'll get back.
Thank you, time.
A couple minutes before he gets back to his talk, is maybe show you who was on the team, maybe tell you a thing or two about them, what they were like in school, or what kind of player they were, or what they ended up doing with their lives.
The upper left is Jim Navarro, and he was a co-captain, his senior. He ended up working in at IBM, and now lives in Florida. And the second guy is Bill Forsythe, who was also a senior. He started the championship game instead of me because the game before I was 0-10. I'm not going to tell you all the stuff that didn't work out well for me, but that was one. I was 0-10, so I was due. Third one on top is Bud Daly, and he's the younger brother of Chuck Daly, who was a Hall of Fame NBA coach. And of the people I ever played with or against in Kane, this guy was the best player. And then the next big guy is Doug Erickson, who was a senior, and he passed away in the last year or so. He lived in central Pennsylvania someplace, and then on his back is Jim Thompson, who was the other co-captain, and he was a senior, and it was he who missed the foul shot that ended up in my talking to you people today. As I said, he probably was the best shot on the team. This is Pat Scordo, and he's a sophomore. He was better known in track, he had a javelin record when he was in high school.
Yeah, I think he won states 3 years in a row.
And then the next person is a coach, Stuart Edwards. And next to Stuart is Fred Pearson, who was a junior. And Fred remained in Kane, and he passed away some time ago. Next to Fred is Ken Carlson, who is a sophomore and probably my best friend in high school. And he lives in Maryland now. And then on the lower right is yours truly. We just enjoyed a real nice lunch. I just wanted to add a couple more things about the ball game. I didn't tell you, but the day of the game, everything in town shut down. All the stores closed, the school closed, the plants closed, everything. It was like Christmas. And it was primarily so the people could get to have time to go to the game. We played on a given night, and the next day we arrived back in a motorcade and were met out on Cemetery Hill. And we must have pulled into the cemetery, one of the cemeteries, because I remember being parked there and just people all over the place. And I mentioned to you, I played in the band, and there was going to be a parade. Now put yourself in the place of the band director at the high school. There's going to be a parade. The band's supposed to be in it. School's out. And who knows who in the band went to the game or didn't go to the game, whatever. In this crowd, and the band director was quite short. He was probably about 5'6". Through this crowd came the band director to tell me that there was going to be a parade and that I was going to play in it. And I wasn't very polite with him that day. Needless to say, I didn't march in the band. Somehow the whole image of myself playing a clarinet marching up Main Street the day after I scored a basket just didn't seem to work. The other two things, that there were two other vivid memories I have about basketball at Kane. One, I intercepted a pass in Warren and dribbled half the length of the court and missed the layup. I can still see that. And the other one was, there was a guy, a fan, who obviously didn't know he was sitting in front of my mother. And he yelled something derogatory about the way I was playing basketball. And my mother hit him with her umbrella. That's pretty much the sum and substance of basketball. I've got looks like you people have more pictures. Actually, look at here.
I brought some in.
On one side is the team, and on the other side is a picture of the parade. So. Is this pretty good, man? You had a motion to work with me on a little extra. address, and the amount relatives. I'd like you to pick, don't tell me what it is, I'd like you to pick a three-digit number. And just, any different numbers, three numbers. Like one, two, three, whatever. Now, you're gonna have to have a pencil, you want my pen?
I have a pencil.
And would you reverse the three-digit number that you selected?
Need some chalk?
I was gonna steal it. Now, so now you have one number that's bigger than the other. Now subtract the smaller one from the larger one. I've got a calculator if you'd like.
I'm prepared.
You're prepared. Did you get an answer?
Yeah.
Just tell me, you got a three-digit answer.
I got a two-digit answer.
A what?
A two-digit.
A two-digit answer? That's throwing me a curve. What's the right digit?
The right digit?
Yeah.
192.
The right digit, one digit, what's the right one? If I said 1, 2, 3, 3 would be the one on the right.
Oh, see, I told you I wasn't good at math.
Let's start all over again.
All right.
Start with three different numbers.
All right, I'll just give you a number.
They're clean slate.
Okay.
You got it?
Mm-hmm.
I'll reverse it.
Okay.
If you pick 1, 2, 3, then the reverse would be 3, 2, 1. Subtract the smaller one from the larger one.
Okay.
Now there are three numbers.
Yeah.
Blank, what's the number on the right?
Seven.
Seven?
Yeah.
Okay, what answer did you get?
297.
You thought I was just a pretty face, didn't you? If anybody, and I can't imagine how historic you can be, but does anybody have any questions or comments about the infamous game?
How'd you get there? How'd you get back?
Pardon?
How did you get down there and how'd you get home? Bus?
Oh, how did we get down? How did we get home? There was we went in cars. For some reason, we took a bus to every other game I ever played in, but in that one, we took cars. I don't know how many cars. Maybe 8. Oh, and one thing I would add, let me just find this. This is in the Kane paper. C. Stuart Edwards, the Kane High basketball coach, is named Kane's Man of the Year. The article said, Edwards and his team have brought more recognition to Kane than any one factor in the life of the community. I didn't appreciate that, but somebody felt that way about it. And I did want to also mention, I'm going to use up all my time.
I have one more question. So, before the game, you were Don Frase, the sophomore. After the game, you were Don Frase, the fifth baller, right? So how did people treat you? Like,
sound immodest, but it really, it got to the point where, and I left town after my senior year, but it got to the point where I really hesitated to go to Main Street when I'd come back fairly frequently, because that's all anybody ever talked about was the basketball game. Here are some things, and it kind of relates to your question. In 1990, I was in China, and we took a tour bus from Beijing to the Great Wall, which is quite a distance, and so on the way, we stopped at a restaurant. And I sat down beside a guy who happened to be from Pittsburgh. And we chatted, and he said, you know, you guys won a state championship. Here we were, half a world away in 1990, talking about the basketball. That's one thing. I have a daughter, and this would have been sometime in the mid-90s. She had a daughter who played soccer. Everybody's daughter played soccer, I guess. And it was some kind of a tournament somewhere in New York State. And she and her husband were at this tournament, watching their daughter play soccer, and they heard somebody nearby mention Pennsylvania. And so my daughter asked them where in Pennsylvania they were from, and they said Emporium. Oh, now, Jimmy Thompson spent his whole post-school career coaching basketball in Emporium. It turned out they knew all about their son was coached by Jim Thompson. They knew all about the game. They heard of me and everything. This is somewhere in New York State. In 1996, my father died. And he was at Cummins Funeral Home. Does everybody know where that funeral home is? You know the parking lot beside the funeral home? That parking lot is where the house used to be that my girlfriend and now wife lived in. So she feels kind of left out. She started in West Side School. That's not there anymore. They moved to Grieve Street. And there was something called Central School on the corner of Edgar and Greaves. That's gone. The high school's gone. And then the cruelest thing of all is her house is gone. So she feels kind of like an orphan. Anyway, I'm at the funeral home at the services for my father, and this guy came in. And he had his two daughters with him, probably 10 or 12 or so. And he said, I heard your father died, and I thought you'd be here, and I wanted to introduce you to my two daughters. And I was introduced as the guy who was the hero of the basketball. So that was in 96. In 2001, it was our 50th high school reunion. I was having breakfast the next day at what was the Hillcrest restaurant, and a woman approached me and said, I'm younger than you, but my dad used to take me to see you play basketball, and she had recently gone to Canada. And she went over the Peace Bridge in Buffalo, and when she gave the customs guy where she lived, where she was born, he said, "You know Don Frase."
Now, knowing all this, would you rather someone else would have tipped that ball in?
No. No, I must admit, it's, I'm really so lucky to have been part of that whole thing without knowing what it was going to be.
Was there a battle for that ball, or you just happened to tip it in? And?
Oh, I was in a perfect position, and it came off perfectly. And
did you bank it, or did you just put it in?
Just put it in. You know, this is another part of how much time do we have?
Yeah, about 12 to 15 minutes.
Okay. Another part of some remarks I wanted to make about other things to you, but speaking of the tip-in, a lot of people said, "Boy, were you lucky." I guess it depends on how you define luck. I define luck as, and I wish somebody would have told me this when I was your age, I define luck as when preparedness meets opportunity. The kind of luck a lot of people think about is if you win the lottery. Well, that doesn't happen very often. But usually when people are lucky, it's because an opportunity came by and they were ready for it. One of the things I didn't tell you when I briefly told you what our practices were like, one of the things we did every single practice was when we weren't shooting shots, we were under the basket tipping them in. And if you haven't been an experience of tipping in a ball, it's not the easiest thing in the world. You don't know where it's going to come down, and you only have time to in this case, if it hadn't have been a tip-in, if I would have rebounded it, the game would have been over. So there was no alternative but to tip it. Anyway. In 2009, a guy named Ed Rose, who used to live in Kane, wrote a book about sports in Kane, and a big chunk of it was the basketball stuff. In 2014, Mr. Seriani arranged to have a new trophy case, which gave it more life. And 2015, here we are. So this is something that certainly wasn't intended, but I'm just really happy to be part of it. It could have been anybody in that picture you saw up there, but it wasn't only one person could do it. So, any other questions or comments about the game?
How about what was high school like? What was Kane like when you were here?
Kane High School?
Yeah, or the town.
Well, for one thing, it was hard to get a place to park on Main Street. You know, that was where the whole town was. It was on Main Street. And there wasn't any out toward the community hospital, supermarket, or anything like that. High school seemed to me to be very friendly, and everybody knew everybody.
What did you do for fun back in that day? Did you have dances in Kane?
Pardon?
Did you have dances in Kane?
There was something called co-ed every Thursday night at the YWCA, which was above the Temple Theater. We had a dance every Thursday night, and then there was a prom.
Did you have a teen club?
A what?
Did you have a teen club?
Scheme?
Team. I think we had a teen club back in that day, a place where young people
could
hang out.
I think, and part of my notes, which I probably won't get to, is I doubt that you people appreciate the quality of life you have growing up in Kane. In fact, I think that's a probably good segue into some comments I want to make. See, I'm flipping all this stuff, you aren't gonna get the benefit. Maybe we should take the rest of the day.
You should just come back.
There's a certain endemic kind of gentility that you people are getting, that you don't get in a lot of places. When my children come to Kane, I have three, they're always kind of surprised at how friendly and how helpful and things like that are with the people here. And I think it's part of being in a small town. If somebody's gonna go to the dentist in Kane, you go to the dentist, and a half hour later, you're ready to do something else. If you work somewhere, some of you probably will work in Warner Bradley. 30 minutes, and that's a long time, Kane, to go to your job, isn't it? You don't spend all your life. Let me show you. For a short time, I moved to Connecticut. And I was with a company that was in Manhattan, knowing they were going to move to Connecticut. So for a couple of years, I commuted from Connecticut to Manhattan. One day, I read about a person who had the longest commute known, or not the longest, the most arduous commute known. The New Yorker magazine. Here's Newburgh, New York, here's the Hudson River. This guy lived in a farm. He grew up in Manhattan. He got married and had children, and he wanted his children to have a rural life, unlike he had, because he grew up in New York. But his job was on Wall Street. Here's where he lived, and here's Newburgh. And down here, about 50 miles, is New York City. Well, his wife in the morning drove him out to the road that goes down along the Hudson River, where he caught a bus. If he missed the bus, he'd hitchhike. His purpose was to get to Newburgh. There was a bridge in Newburgh. He got on a bus in Newburgh and went over to Danbury, Connecticut. Got off the bus, got on a train, and went to Norwalk, Connecticut. From Norwalk, he went down to New York at Grand Central. He took a subway down to Wall Street and walked 10 blocks to his office. How'd you like to do that? On a good day, it was 3 hours. And when I commuted from about right here, knowing that it wasn't gonna last. Ask anybody that works in New York how long it takes to commute, and they'll tell you an hour and a half. And that's a standard answer. That was my answer. And I think the reason is it somehow got started. If you told somebody it was longer than an hour and a half, they think you were kind of nuts, particularly if you came from Kane. And if you told them less than an hour and a half, they wouldn't believe you. So it's an hour and a half. I never made it to New York in an hour and a half from my house, but ask me to commute, it's an hour and a half. Anyway, that's another advantage. If there's more family time and more time with neighbors, less crime. One time I had the whole family in the car and we were coming to Kane for some reason, I think a funeral, and there was the radio station in Kane and the news were on. It was on the hour, and there was some Kane news, and started out with, the Kane police reported no activity last night. My kids couldn't believe it. They still, this was 20 years ago, and they still talk about it. The weather. Everybody I know who has left Kane wishes they had weather like Kane. No place like it. You may think it's cold, but cold and humid and hot and humid is not nearly as pleasant as dry and cold and dry and warm. And you know, when where I live, when it's, my wife's from Kane, and when it's 70 degrees, which is pretty rare because it's usually more than that. When it's 70 degrees, we say, well, gee, this feels just like Kane. Tranquility. There's a town between Rochester and Buffalo named Batavia. Batavia it's a little bigger than Kane, but it's a fairly small town. There's a guy in Batavia who grew up in New York City, and his parents retired, and they moved to Batavia to live with him. Batavia has a racetrack. That's probably why Batavia is there. It's a pretty well-known racetrack in that part of the world. This fellow's parents got so bored living with him that they got an apartment by the racetrack. I doubt if anybody here would want to live by a racetrack, but that was their preference, more like home. I want to give you another handout. Part of this, I attached something here. Part of it is about working and sweating the small stuff. And I wrote this when I was at the university and ended up in the Wall Street Journal. So I thought it was pretty good. So there's that. And then there's the picture, which is just to show you that I did play. And then entertainment on the other side. What my point was in that article, and it's part of another section that I'd hope to get to today, is quite often we don't make sure that things are done that aren't too hard to do. And that doesn't mean they aren't as critical as other things. And some examples are two space shuttle disasters that were, one was done because they lifted off when they shouldn't have because the temperature wasn't right. Another one was when a piece of foam broke off the heat shield and hit the wing. And in both those cases, you think about all that went into building a space shuttle. In both those cases, there were six people lost in each one. One happened to be the first school teacher that was going to go into space. Well, anyway, you have done so well. Could I bother you for one more? Would you, on the other side of that, there are six sets of numbers. The numbers, and each set is somewhat different, but the numbers range from 1 to 60. Would you just pick a number? And I'm going to ask you, I think, I'm going to ask you to tell me one by one whether or not that number is on each of the sets. So if you look at set A, is the number on there? Yes. How about set B? Nope. Set C? Nope. Set D?
Yeah.
Okay. Set E? I gave you these because you can have fun with these. If anytime I ask you about one of these sets, if you said yes, I added the upper right number. You had set one was the upper right number is a one, and then set D, was it? No.
Yeah,
it was eight. Yeah, it said D, the upper right number was an eight. So those were the two that had the nine on. So any you can play your games with this as long as you can mentally add. Anytime somebody correctly says yes, you add that number that's on the upper right and you'll have the number.
Well, any last questions? Any last comments? How about a nice round of applause for Dawn?
Well, very much. I'm honored to be here, and I appreciate your attention, and even laughing at my little joke. You want to know this other one?
Yeah,
I can
do that.
If you reverse a number, a three-digit number, and subtract, the middle number is always 9.